Hi guys, so I'm back here with the DaySky D-Book Pro. Now, if you've seen my review of that one, that the thermals weren't so great on it. It got up to 80 degrees. And I've done some investigating here because normally these companies will put on some really cheap thermal paste. And just take a look at this. I'm going to pull up now. This is the heatsink for the CPU. And they've used some like putty style, almost like a thermal pad there. That is absolutely horrible what they've used there. So no surprising that this reaches 80 degrees. It should actually be a lot less than that considering it's fan cooled, and normally this processor is just passively cooled. So in this video, I'm going to repaste it. I'm also going to repaste the GPU, which is right here to the right of the screen, and we're going to have a look at the thermals once I do the repaste, and also I'm going to do a little bit of overclocking too. Now, word of warning, when you're cleaning it, just be careful with those resistors all around the sides, so you don't want to damage them. If you damage one of them, then it's game over for the CPU. And also make sure you're not touching your cat, your dog, and if you can, use a static, anti-static bench there so you don't run into any problems with that. Earth yourself as well, so touch a computer case or something like that is always handy. So I'm going to use a little bit of Arctix MX4 on this. Now, you don't need to use a high-quality compound because this is only going to reach about 10 watts without the integrated GPU. If you were using the integrated GPU and you don't have any power limits, which I haven't at the moment set, I've got them disabled. So yeah, I've got a little bit too much on there really, but it doesn't matter. Now any excess there, you can see I spilt a little bit. This is quite a poor, sloppy job. But I'm going to use what's called the Begi Method. I spread it out now just with a little bit of a plastic bag on my finger there, just to make sure that it's going to cover that die nicely there. And we've got full proper coverage of that. Because I mean, you can put a pea size on there in the middle and it'll spread out evenly. But like this, I know that at least I've got full 100% coverage right there and contact when I put the heatsink back on and screw that in place. So now I'll get that heatsink back in place and simply just place it on top, of course, and then we're going to screw it in. So you go from one end to the other diagonally to make sure you get even pressure then. So screwing one side, you can see I've got the upper left hand one screwed in. Now I'm going to screw in this right one here, and now I'm just putting in that last screw. So hopefully this will drop temperatures maybe about 5 to 10 degrees or so with this repaste. But that's not the main concern. The main concern is the GPU, which I'll move on to next, because that got up to 90 degrees in my testing after gaming for a few hours. So with the GPU here, you can see the 1 gigabyte chip and another gigabyte chip there of the Samsung RAM. We've got 2 gigabytes in total, double data rate 3. And we do have this ribbon cable that is covering one of the screws that we need to get access to. Now these ribbon cables, the plugs are very delicate, and I don't like to touch them, but of course we have to here. So you have to lift up this little plastic tab and just be real careful about that. See how I lifted that up like that? And then just slide that out and just move that up, and now we've got access to that screw we need to get off to get the heatsink off. Okay, so let's have a look and see if they use that horrible thermal paste or that pad just like the CPU. Oh no, they've actually put some proper thermal paste on this one, which is good. Now, because this GPU is getting up to almost 90 degrees, I'm going to add a little bit more copper here, I think, is the only way really to try and lower those temperatures and perhaps put some thermal pads on as well. So I have a shim here that's 20 by 20, 1 millimeter thick. Now, okay, it does get a little bit close to those resistors either side, but I have done this before in the past, and I've had systems running for years like this without any problems, without it shorting out any of those little resistors either side. So that's my plan there. That'll go on the top, and then the heatsink, this will screw back on, and it should apply even more pressure to that. So hopefully that'll keep that on there nice and firm, and hopefully lower temperatures about 10 degrees. So I've used the bag method again, so the plastic bag has smoothed out that thermal paste on there, giving a perfect, nice, even layer there, you can see. And I didn't go overboard this time, as I did that off camera. So now to put this on top, so you need to really position it right in the middle there. Just give it a tiny little bit of a wiggle. It should stay there. Now, I don't believe that that is going to slide around or move. If you're worried about this, then use some thermal adhesive between these two here, but I'm just going to go with the thermal paste as well, because it normally tends to stick it down and glue it in there quite well, then it shouldn't shift around as mentioned. So I've got some thermal paste now on the heatsink, you can see right there. So again, I've just used the plastic bag there to spread it out nice and evenly, and I'll put this on top now and screw everything in place. Okay, so it's a bit of a squeeze getting this on, but I did some checks before I actually screwed it all in place, that the lid's still going to fit on, but it will be now in contact with this, touching and putting a little bit of pressure on. But that's good. It's good to have that pressure as well applying down on the top, just to make sure it's got even better contact there. Now, to get this ribbon back in, you simply have to just place it in there. So slip it back in, and it's a little tricky to do. You just got to try and get it in like about there. So you can see it's now in place. You can't push it in any further, and then that tab, just clip it down. So I'll show you a quick before and after. So it got up to 88 degrees. In fact, it was 90 degrees, the maximum the GPU would get up to. It is now 81 degrees max. So we've improved it by about 9 degrees, which is not a lot, but that's going to give me a little bit of headroom here to do some overclocking. In fact, I'm already running an overclock, and that temperature I showed you before, the 88 degrees, was with the clocks at stock. So the more you overclock the CPU, or the core of the GPU, sorry, then the hotter it's going to get there, of course. Now, this next part here is for really experts only, and those that want to get maximum performance. So what I'm going to do now is show you how to flash a edited BIOS with overclocks onto it, because you cannot change the clocks through something like Afterburner, MSI Afterburner I do have here running, but you cannot change the GPU clocks. NVIDIA locked us out of this on the 9000 series. I think that's the reason why. Now, you can overclock the memory, which I recommend to do to find out where a stable memory overclock is, and you can use that later on. So first off, we have to get this right here, which is GPU Z. Now, take a BIOS dump. So you're going to save the BIOS to a file right here, which I'm about to do now, you can see. And this will cause the screen to probably freeze for a second. Now, with that BIOS saved, we can now edit it. So what we're going to do now is just get this program here. Now, I'll give you all of these files. There's a link in the description. This is called Maxwell 2 BIOS Tweaker, and it is basically just an editor. So we want to open that BIOS that we just dumped, because this is the one we're going to flash. Right here, I've actually got one that I've already done some edits on. So this is for my own system. Now, I tried the memory at 1250. Now, this memory clock for me has been perfectly fine and stable, testing out all games for a couple of hours. No artifacts, no glitches. This is really good. Now, my clock, I've got a boost clock here of 12025. That's what I'm going to test out, and that's all I have changed. You save it once you do the edits to the boost clock right here, and then the memory clock. The power table, I think you might actually need to adjust this as well. Sorry, not the power table, the boost table, this one here. I've set that to the max clock of what my max boost is going to be right here. So that's that there. Then you tap on save BIOS. And now we're going to flash that over. So this part is risky, and I don't recommend doing this. If you don't want to take this risk, if you don't want to accidentally end up bricking the 940M, then please do not continue with this here. This is all at your own risk, but this is get the maximum performance out of the GPU, and I will show you the results afterwards that it does boost it up quite a bit. So now we need to head to the device manager. So right click the Windows Start button, Device Manager, and we're going to basically disable the GPU so we can flash it. This has to be done, or otherwise you will not be able to flash it. So you go to Display Adapters, and then click on the NVIDIA GeForce, and sorry, this touchpad is such a pain to use, and right click it, and then disable device. So once that happens, it will be then disabled. We're ready to flash. And now we need to go down to the command prompt, and we need to run this as admin. So just type in CMD in the search bar. This is the easiest way to do this. And then right click that, and run as administrator. So with the files I have to download in the description, there's the link there, the download. Extract that to your C drive, which I have already done, and it's a folder called mvflash. This is the program used to flash it. So I need to then move over to that folder. So I've already got some commands here, just to make things a little quicker for this video. So I'm gonna paste that in here. So what I'm doing now is just changing the file over to mvflash. And now I'm running this command here. So this command, basically what it's doing is index 0 is going to be the NVIDIA GPU, because we do have two GPUs on the system, the integrated Intel one. And now it's going to select that, and now it's going to flash my ROM called ROM. How original, ROM. So that's going to start to flash it now. You can see it come up. Now it'll tell you the board version. All of this should be the same. The IDs, if there's any difference in there, do not flash them. Update display adapter. So you hit yes. You'll hear a little beep from the speakers. And now it's telling me that it is flashing that. Okay, so that's it. It seems so simple. Of course, I'm making this process look a little simple here. So it's now flashed those custom clocks over to the GPU. You want to go back into the device manager now and just right click this, of course, and enable the device again. We want that GPU back online, and now reboot your PC and those clocks should take if you didn't run into any issues, but make sure you've got that backup of the original BIOS just in case you do something wrong there. Now we'll have a look at the performance difference from stock to overclocked. Now to get a gauge on what kind of improvements we can expect when you do a little bit overclocking. So I always knew that the Maxwell architecture in the past, that it does overclock quite well, especially on the desktop cards. So this is the stock score here of the Heaven benchmark that I showed in my full review. Now with my overclock with 1300 on the core clock that I flashed that BIOS and 1250 on the RAM, check out this difference. So it's gone up now to 452. So what does that mean? That's actually about 36% improvement there on that score. So that is massive, huge difference there gained from overclocking. So this is now Geekbench 4. This is the default score. Again, no overclocking here. 22,000. Very low, not very good at all. And then with my overclock, it's almost hit now 30,000. So that is a big improvement. That is around 25-26% increase there. Not as good as Heaven, so it's going to vary. But I will check this out now and we'll take a look at Grand Theft Auto 5 and see if the frame rate has also improved there. So I'm going to run it with the same settings I did in my review. So 720p on the lowest settings here. And performance to me has improved around about 3-4 frames per second. See, I'm getting about 34 frames per second at the moment. The problem with this game here, like most modern titles, is it needs a lot more powerful CPU in it. The system is bottlenecked by, of course, the CPU. You can see it's running at 100%. And the GPU is not even running at maximum capacity. It's only about 50% there. So it really hasn't made too much of a difference. The game is still playable, of course, at 720p. It's just that problem there with the GPU really maxing things out. You can see outside here now 34 or 35 frames per second. This is actually not bad at all. And I would say, yeah, about 4 frames per second more. And after my overclocking, you can see that the Rise of the Tomb Raider, this score has increased quite a bit as well, giving us about an extra 7 or 8 frames per second in 720p on the lowest settings, which is quite an increase. So there we go, you can see that a repaste and adding that extra copper has made a huge difference to the thermals, and I was able to do quite a bit of overclocking here, and reasonably good results out of that. I mean, it's boosted the performance around 25% for the GPU, but the problem with this laptop, like I mentioned in my review, is that a lot of these games and newer titles will be limited and bottlenecked by that weak Celeron N3450 CPU. So that's the main problem with this laptop here, but good to see that we can at least increase the performance. Now, I didn't really comment much on the CPU thermals because it doesn't actually go over 60 degrees now with me applying that repaste to it. So definitely recommend that if you are going to get this laptop or you have one, then at least do a repaste. And a little bit of caution there with flashing the BIOS to the GPU, because if things go wrong, you could end up with having a completely bricked NVIDIA 940M, which wouldn't be great. Thanks a lot for watching this video, and I do hope to see you back in the channel. Bye for now.